A good storyteller sometimes uses apparent exaggeration in order to challenge his listeners to see things in a new way. Jesus, of course, was not just a good storyteller. Jesus was the greatest storyteller who ever lived. He mostly taught by telling parables. These parables of Jesus were deliberately designed to get his listeners to think about God and their own lives in new ways. The stories were fashioned to challenge ordinary values and mundane preconceptions. And their twists and turns, their surprise elements, their exaggerations are what enable the parable to do its work. These life-changing stories begin to reveal the deepest mysteries of the kingdom of God. They accomplish this task by teasing old convictions and inviting new experiences of the wondrous promises of God. So always look for the point in the parable that's the hardest to swallow, where the dissonance is the greatest between your past understanding and the Lord's new teaching. That is exactly where the good news is being announced. Now, the first listeners who heard Jesus tell today's parable knew everything there was to know about first century farming in Palestine. But today, living in the 21st century, living here in central Illinois, surrounded by some of the richest farmland in the entire world, we may be thinking only in terms of modern farming. And so we could entirely miss the shocking exaggeration in this parable. First century farmers living in rocky and arid Palestine knew that in those days, you always sowed first and plowed second. In other words, you first scattered the seed all over the place and only later plowed the seed into the ground. In that method of sowing, some seed would do well. Some seed would not do so well, and some seed in every single growing season would certainly die. Now here comes the twist in today's parable that the ancients would have immediately seen. They all knew there was no way that any farmer, no matter how skilled or hardworking, was ever going to get a 30-fold, a 60-fold, much less a 100-fold harvest out of any field, no matter where the seed had fallen. That kind of yield in those ancient days, without fertilizer or irrigation or pesticides, was simply impossible to achieve. That kind of unprecedented abundance was wildly out of proportion to any farmer's most determined efforts. That's the surprising good news in the parable of the sower and the seed. Jesus reveals that preaching about the kingdom of God produces a harvest that will be simply amazing. Sowing the seed of God's word will produce a richness that no one would ever imagine, much less predict. Because a preacher or a teacher may do the sowing, but it is always the Holy Spirit that produces the huge harvest. So despite all obstacles, the despite all opposition to Jesus Christ and to his church, despite human sin and weakness, despite everything, God himself will ultimately produce an astounding, a stupendous harvest. And not just a good harvest, an extraordinary harvest, beyond our wildest dreams or our most extravagant hopes. The psalmist once prophesied of sowing the seeds of the kingdom of God. He chanted, "Those who sow in tears will reap in joy." They go out full of tears, carrying the seed for sowing. They come back full of sorrow, carrying their sheaves. That kind of victorious harvest is also what the prophet Jeremiah envisioned. Today's first reading. God himself, through the prophet, promises, "I will appoint over you a shepherd after my own heart, and you will multiply and become fruitful in the land. They will call Jerusalem the throne of the Lord. There all nations will be gathered together to honor the name of the Lord. They will walk no longer in hard-heartedness and wickedness." In the very same way, God's word will certainly achieve what God wills. God's word makes miracles happen. God's word produces exactly what God wills. This is the same kind of abundant harvest by which God's Holy Spirit can entirely transform our individual lives. The Spirit gives us the freedom to be born again and to live entirely new and resurrected lives. That same Spirit will also change the whole of creation, ending this present groaning and agony, perfecting and completing the universe in the marvelous way God has always designed. So at this charismatic conference, we too need to be amazed and open our minds and hearts to the parable of the sower and the seed, and to the unexpected plenitude of the kingdom of God. How many times in our own experience has the word of God fallen on rocky soil or gotten all choked up by weeds? How many times do we start thinking too small when we try to imagine the greatness of God and the power of the Spirit? How many times do we presume to know everything about beginnings and endings, about sowing and about reaping? How many times do we try to measure the power of God by the measure of man? That's why we will always need the twists and turns, the parables of Jesus. Their exaggerations, their surprise elements, and their challenges that can turn our world and each one of us upside down. After all, the same powerful and effective word of God that changes ordinary bread and wine into the very body and blood of Christ can also certainly change our lives into something entirely new. We all can become more faith-filled disciples, more energetic sowers of the seed. Through the gift of God's grace, we can become the saints of God. The Holy Spirit continues to make promises we might hardly believe, and the Holy Spirit reveals amazing truths that surpass everything we may already know or ever before dreamed of. Because the gospel is an invitation, begin to see the reign of God as God sees it, not the way we used to think. The parables of Jesus, if we only let them do their work, make us vulnerable before Almighty God, available for God's unexpected interventions. The gospel proclaims a new heaven and a new earth. The gospel asks that we decide. The gospel demands that we change. The words of Jesus show us that the power of God is everlasting, and that his great love is without end. So we can pray with renewed confidence. Come, Holy Spirit, and enkindle the hearts of your faithful. Fill them with the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and we shall be recreated, and you will renew the face of the earth. May we all drink fully of that happy inebriation of the Holy Spirit. May this divine intoxication inflame our hearts, illuminate our minds, and fill us with new zeal. Because God's promised harvest will be vast and endless.